Sewing machine oil. And one is really thin, two is for like used ones, and then one is thin and not ultra thin, so if they're really hard, two is one that's really stiff. I use that for like But ultra is a little heavier than the thickness, so it's just sluggish.
Alright, ready? Alright, who's talking in the back here, folks? Welcome, everyone. Thank you for coming. We're gonna get started. Thank you all for coming to the morning session. And I'm really excited to be here at Detroit Wayne Music Studio. Is that right?
Yes.
I know, wasn't it called the Saxophone Center?
Detroit Saxophone.
It is.
It is.
Okay. Oh, it is both. Okay.
Yeah, it's both.
Alright, I just wanna make sure I got that right.
But today we are the Detroit Trumpet Center.
There you go.
Exactly.
So welcome to the Detroit Wayne Trumpet Center. And I definitely want to thank everyone here for having me. So it's great that these guys are hosting us and giving us a space to have this opportunity. And it's a perfect size space. Yesterday we had a clinic, and we actually had like a lot of people. There's no way they would have fit in here. But this is going to be perfect for today. And I really want to be able to touch on all of your questions and your ideas and your experiences, so there's a small enough group that we can do that. I also want to mention that there are all kinds of trumpets on the walls, and I understand they're all for sale. So if you guys are looking for something that's not in my realm of what I do, then of course this is a good place to do it. And you want to spread the word as well. If you know somebody that's looking for a horn, that's something you see here, you know, you want to mention that, because I want to make sure to support these guys as well. And they do ultrasonic cleaning, they do repairs and service on trumpets as well. Maybe all of you guys already know that. But we should definitely spread the word and support these guys. So I want to get started today. First, I'm just going to orient you to what we brought with us. Over here, we have a bunch of horns, thanks to Gary. We have, I'll just run down all of them. An E-flat, this is a Summit E-flat. We have a Summit C-trumpet with a long bell. We have the Summit Midnight, which is the dark number 8 bell. And this one's in the midnight finish. We have a Summit 1 finished in 24 karat gold. All four of those horns are here thanks to Gary. Please, if you play these horns, be very careful. When you pick them up, set them down. If you're wearing rings or jewelry, please take it off before you handle anything. If you have questions and you want to understand how to do something on the horn, we'll help you. But these are Gary's horns. I want to make sure nothing happens to them. And then this is Gary Shire's trumpet that we put a mod kit on and a Venturi gap receiver. The VGR is the AGR. It's the same thing. I used to call it the adjustable gap receiver. Now we call it the Venturi gap receiver because it adjusts the gap in the Venturi. I'll talk about that in a bit. This horn is here, compliments of Jennifer Sandquist. This is her horn. And I brought one of my own. This is a VPS Summit. And all of these horns up here are VPS, meaning that they have features on them that make them suitable for really any player. They have a variable performance system, which includes the VGR. So I'll discuss all of those things as you ask questions. And then over here, we have a lot of other things. We have a grouping of mod kits. We have finger buttons. Some are Powa, some are the new dichroic glass. The dichroic glass is going to be released on Kickstarter at the end of the month or early in December. We're trying to get it all finished right now. That's a new option that we have not been able to offer before. So we're real excited about that. But if you haven't seen them, come up and check them out. The glass is not glued into these, so it's not gonna fall out. But just so you know, they're not actually finished. These are all the first prototype run. But that's something that you will be able to purchase if you have a set of my finger buttons that are the Mod 2 style. Then you can buy the tops and screw them on. If you have a Bach or a Yamaha or a Schilke or something else, then you can buy different bases and you can interchange the tops between the bases. So that is the new dichroic glass. We have the gap solution kit. I think everybody here knows what that is. Thanks to Gary and Otto. And then we have some lead pipes. This mouthpiece strayed. And then we have a few cutaways of mouthpieces. See if I can tilt those up. And we'll talk about those. A tuning slide. I just brought that to show off some of the cool stuff we can do on it. And then the 5mm. And the 5mm is the modular mouthpiece system. We will discuss that as far in depth as you would like. But primarily, I'm going to share with you information on really just the physics of trumpet playing. So I'm kind of getting all this stuff out of the way right now. So you know what I brought, because a lot of you just want to play with the toys. But at the same time, I'm really here to just give you ideas on how you can become better players. And a lot of you may have way more experience than I do in some areas, so you may be able to share that with the group as well, so we can all learn from each other. And then last, down here, we have some little swag bags, meaning there's like stickers and business cards, and some of them have pens in them. We have some keychains with t-shirts and some water bottles, and I'll be giving that stuff away today so that we encourage participation. So hopefully everyone will participate, and then we'll all have some fun. And I'm supposed to stand right here. So here we go. So today's topic is really range, endurance, and the physics of brass playing. So what I'm going to discuss applies to all brass playing instruments. Some of the things might be a little bit backwards on some instruments, but everyone here plays trumpet, so we don't have to address those other things unless you ask me. I did some experiments years ago when Jen and I were in the Waconia space, when I was teaching a studio of 80 students. And I used to teach a lot, and I'd perform a lot, and I didn't build horns as often. So I'd only spend like 30 or 40 hours a week building horns, and then I was literally spending 40 hours a week teaching. And then I'd gig all the time. When I was doing that, I had all these ideas about how to teach beginning students a new approach to brass playing. And you've seen all the different books out there, so-and-so's approach to brass playing, this and that. And for years I thought, there's really no reason to write this down or to share it with the trumpet community, only because there were so many books out there. But I've read all the books, and they are actually different. They're different than what I do by quite a bit. So I've put off the project of having a book or a program simply because I've been doing this, been building horns. And now I'm to the point where I want to release that and start to share it with everyone, and it's known as Trumpet Momentum. And some of you saw the Momentum project, some of you even backed it. Is everyone familiar with the little spinning top? Have you guys heard of that? So the Momentum project really does tie into learning anything in life and changing your habits, and really just getting to the root programming of your mind so that you can learn to do things differently on a fundamental level. So there's a spinning top, which is really kind of a meditative tool that goes along with everything I'm going to talk about. We don't need that right now. We're really just going to talk about how brass playing works and how we can take all the pieces of brass playing and find which components are necessary to create balance so we can play the full range of the instrument with endurance. So I want to walk you through a little bit of how I used to teach beginning players years ago. I should preface this with one thing. When I was in college, well, first when I was in high school, there was a day where I suddenly started practicing 4 hours a day. I had never practiced before. I had only played like 1 or 2 minutes before, literally like practicing. Then one day someone inspired me, some of you have heard the story, and I went home and practiced for 4 hours. Well, I did that every day, and I did that for years. And for 10 years I practiced 2 to 4 hours almost every single day. Even if I was sick, I would practice. And I got to be a pretty good player, but I had some issues. And because I learned so quickly and I didn't have any guidance, I had some really bad habits that set me back. So to get past that, I studied all the best trumpet players' embouchures that I could. I looked at every video. Back then we had VHS. When I was in college, I went to the music library, and I checked out every single record album. Back then there were records. And I'd look at the covers, and I'd take notes on what the embouchure looked like for each great player. And I'd listen to the album, and I would make notes. And I had this huge compilation of all these players, all these albums, what I saw in the pictures or in the videos, and what I heard on the recordings. Was this recording one where they were having some issues in some areas? Because you can hear that on really professionally recorded things. You can hear that that player actually wasn't having a great day. Or was this player so strong that I couldn't believe it, and they were like my idol, okay? And what I discovered was some very great players throughout their careers, a lot of them, had issues. They had embouchure issues. Things weren't going right. Those range from Freddie Hubbard to Miles Davis to Wynton Marsalis to Rolf Smedvig of Vampire Brass, Phil Smith, the New York Philharmonic, Adolf Herseth. All those people had down days. Now, I never heard Adolf Herseth miss a note, but I did hear that he wasn't as strong on this recording as he was on another one. And I started to put all this information together to try to understand how and why players succeed, especially on really demanding gigs or recordings, and what separates the best players from me, because I was having problems. My range suffered, my endurance suffered. I was actually playing and it was creating serious pain. And it was painful for me because I had basically made the decision early on that I was going to devote myself to trumpet and be the best trumpet player I could and do that for a living. And a lot of us have been there. We're like, this is what I'm going to do, you know? So I learned a lot from that. I took a whole year off. Before I took that year off of playing trumpet, I wrote basically all the information I thought was necessary to go from a beginning player to being able to play with the best tone and range and endurance. It had nothing to do with fingering, had nothing to do with musicality, had nothing to do with arpeggios or scales. It was just the physics of playing. And because I was studying physics in school, I approached it from a physics standpoint. I wrote it all down, I put it away, I put my horn away. We moved to Las Vegas, I became a police officer, forgot about trumpets, did other things. Then one day, like a year and a half later, I pulled it all out and I read what I had put down for the first day, and I played what I had put down for the first day, which was play for 2 minutes. And the next day, I did what it said, and the next day and next day. And after 2 weeks, I had the range and endurance that I have now. After 2 weeks, it really was only 2 weeks. And it wasn't surprising to me because I knew it could work, but what surprised me was that I had to take a year and a half off to learn it. And the reason I had to take a year and a half off is because I was used to doing it this way. I kept doing it wrong again and again and again. And I think to myself, I need to change all these things. Today when I wake up and play, I'm gonna change them all right now. But I couldn't do that. So I finally gave up and I said, I have to put it away and come back to it after I've forgotten how it works. So the spinning top, the trumpet momentum, that whole angle on this is to take the place of having to take a year and a half off. I found that there are other ways to get there. First is learn it right the first time. Second is forget how to do it the wrong way. So the best way to learn everything I'm going to teach you is to clear your mind and forget about everything you know or you think you know and just start over. Have an open mind and say, oh, I'll try this new thing. So the spinning top is really to get you into a meditative state where if you do that every day, you can start to get to the fundamental level of your thinking and reprogram your mind and do things differently. That's why that exists. So we're going to talk about all of that, and the way we're going to do it today is we're going to have a first trumpet lesson. So if someone would like to volunteer, I will give someone their very first trumpet lesson, as if you were a 10-year-old coming in for your fifth grade lesson. Anyone want to do that? Volunteer, it'll be fun. Yeah? Awesome. All right, well, come on up.
Bring my horn?
Yeah, bring your horn, bring your mouthpiece.
But don't bring all you know about trumpet. You have to leave that here.
It's over there.
Jen, are we both going to fit in the viewer? So we're gonna pretend that Guyman is coming in for his first lesson, and that we are gonna explore the instrument for the very first time. Now, obviously, you know a lot about the trumpet.
Yes.
So you don't need to be doing this, but your goal is really to just play along and hopefully get into a mindset where you can start to discover things for yourself. What I've learned in doing these lessons is I actually have very little to do with it. What I have always done is guide people through the way they think about the physics and help them see how and why it works, but discovering it themselves. And I want each of you to discover it yourselves. So you want to approach it a little bit like this. Now, it's different because we all know how to play trumpet. So we can't actually come in here for the first time and learn it. But what if it was your first time you were ever going to do archery? Or the first time you were going to do downhill skiing? Or the first time you ever did martial arts? Then, I mean, all of you have probably not done all those things. So the first time you do those things, you kind of have a clear mind. You're like, I'm not really sure what to do. If it were martial arts, you'd think, oh, Bruce Lee did some stuff. I don't know what it was. And then you would just listen and follow along and learn from the beginning. That's what we're going to do. But instead of me telling you what to do, I'm going to ask you to tell me how it works. So you decided you wanted to play trumpet. When did you start?
52 years ago.
Okay. So was it school band?
School band, yes.
Okay. And what was your very first experience when you were playing trumpet? Like the very first time you got to put the mouthpiece in the horn. Describe that for us.
It was difficult to understand what made a sound.
Mm-hmm.
And what and how to had to discover how to make a sound.
Okay.
Correct sound.
And did someone show you or give you an analogy? Do you remember?
Yes.
Okay. And what was that?
And that is, don't blow into the horn, quote unquote, spit into the horn.
Okay. So spit into the horn. Some of us have heard that, right?
Yeah.
I wouldn't disagree with that because, I mean, like, that kind of approach works with a lot of students or a lot of people. Do you have any insight on that? Like, how do you think that works?
Well, a variation of spitting works.
Mm-hmm. You're not really spitting.
No.
Okay.
But that was what I was told.
Sure.
So in other words, to go through that motion, to act like you're going to do that,
mm-hmm.
produce a sound, all of a sudden the sound comes out without actually spitting into the horn.
So when you're spitting, are you thinking, my lips are closed and you push them open?
Yes.
Okay, so yes. Like,
yeah.
Kind of thing?
Yeah.
Or something like that?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, now that you've given us some idea on how it works back then when you first started, what's your impression now? Like, how does it work?
It works by producing an aperture,
okay.
With the lips and allowing to control the air
mm-hmm.
going through the aperture that controls the sound or the what causes the sound.
Okay. So you're saying we have air
yeah.
and we have lips and somehow that creates a sound. How does that actually work? Well, that's the good part about this whole situation is then we can start thinking, well, what is happening? Like physically, what happens? And if this was your very first time ever doing it, then you would actually have more ideas than you do right now. Because our mindset right now is, well, I just played a trumpet. But if it were a very first time, you'd think to yourself, well, how does that work? Now, if this were martial arts and I asked someone how you could throw someone on the floor just by grabbing their wrist, then you would start to think about it and you'd say, well, what was going on when that person approached, he grabbed their wrist and they fell on the floor. And you would start to think through it, and if you saw it a few times, you'd say, well, you grabbed his wrist and then you twisted it just the right way, you pulled him off balance, and when he was off balance, you pulled his balance towards the floor over there. And now I get how it worked, like I've got some understanding of it. But because we've been playing trumpet for years, we're not thinking, hey, we've got air, we've got lips, what's creating the sound? But now let's do that. So what is doing it? If we're actually, go ahead and play a few notes. Awesome. So now when you're playing, you've got your air and your lips. Give us some more descriptors. What do you think's happening?
Well, air is being forced through the horn.
Mm-hmm.
It's going around.
It is, yeah. Let's talk about where it goes.
Well, it goes through a series of channels, and which is altered by implementing different channels to make the different.
So this is the stuff we would talk about in lessons. Like with the very first day, I would talk about all this. So let's trace it. It comes in the mouthpiece, which I don't have one in there. Just to be correct about that. Comes in the mouthpiece, so the air is coming in, goes around the tuning slide, comes in here, and then it's mystery land, right? What happens? So I'll tell you, with no valves down, it goes through these little ports right there, those little connectors, and then it would come out here and around and out the bell. That's where it goes. So think of the trumpet as one long tube. Now that plays, right? We all know that. What if we were to push one of the valves down?
It's going to shorten or lengthen one of the distance that it has to travel.
Sure. Yeah, so it's going to change the distance, right? All right, so in physics, this is easy to figure out. When we are playing higher pitches, we have a different length than when we play lower pitches. Now, instead of thinking about the trumpet, think about the brass wind family. The piccolo trumpet is a little tiny guy. And then the bass trumpet, or you could even go all the way down to the tuba, is really big, right? So the low notes are produced by what kind of length?
Longer.
And then the high notes are produced by shorter. Pretty simple. But how many of us stop and think about that? Because, I mean, we know, oh yeah, piccolo trumpet's smaller. But you're not thinking, what is the length? So now, if you're playing a C, how can you make it just a little bit lower?
Lengthen the distance.
Yeah, lengthen the distance. So the tube that lengthens it the least amount is that one. So now instead of it being like 49 inches, it's actually 49.7 inches. Now it's a few inches longer. Now how could we make it a little longer than that? First valve, right? And this is the self-discovery stuff that I do because I want people to understand the whole thing. And I'm not telling you this whole thing so you get good at teaching students lessons. I'm telling you because it's a way of just exploring the trumpet and discovering things. Because as we do more and more of this, you're going to say, wait a minute, I never ever thought of that stuff. You just introduced me to something, or maybe you introduced yourself to something you never thought of. Light bulbs will go on in the next 45 minutes where you're like, wait a minute, I should have thought of that years ago. So each one is making it longer and longer and longer. So when we do this, then we have found half step, whole step, one and a half steps, or one semitone, two, three. Now this is actually the next logical combination. It's not this. Because this is the same length as these two combined. So if you want to go lower than that, what do?
Start again.
So I'm here. Now you just want to add another one, right? So that's a little lower. And we all know this. And then what? That. And that. And now we're as low as we can go, but there's nothing left, right? Could you put another valve and make them longer?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes. Could you have 17 valves? Mm-hmm. You could. And there were really crazy musical instruments made in the 1800s that did stuff like that. When they invented these different types of valves, then makers were like, oh, let's do all this crazy stuff. So now, can you explain to me how we do this? All right. Mystery, right? That's the big mystery. Like, well, what just happened there? How about this? Yeah, what is going on? I didn't push anything, right? Okay, let's think about the physics of the instrument for a minute and start to explore what created the first tone. What did this? Why did we get that note?
The instrument gave us allowed us a frequency. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and it's determined by the
amount of air, the length of the.
And the length. Yeah, I know you're thinking it. Yeah. So it's determined by the length, but it's also determined by some quality of the air. We know that because what if I play this? That doesn't sound right. right? Because my pitch, the airspeed and the pitch that I put into the instrument wasn't matched to the length. So what do we call it when you match the pitch that you're putting into the instrument when it matches the length? What is that called? What's the difference between this and this? Yeah, right. But there's a word that we use in music, it's called resonance. Yeah, so it's resonating, right? Listen to this. So I'm playing non-resonant stuff, which sounds kind of jazzy. That's not resonant, right? But what's this? Every pitch to the length of the instrument every time, except some of those notes are higher than the ones we learned before. How does that work? How can I play it? How is it possible? What's happening that's different in my air? Try it. Play C to G.
C to D.
Good. Play the low one. I'll play the G and the staff, so they're just both open. Boom. So you're not changing your vowels. Do it again and think to yourself, what is changing?
The rate of air.
Okay. All right.
And the position of the mouthpiece, I suppose.
Yeah. So you're changing stuff, right?
Yeah.
The air is changing, and your aperture is changing somehow. So now, who can tell me what's happening there?
Airspeed.
Airspeed? Okay, so what happens, Andy?
Faster to go to the higher note.
Okay. Anybody else? What else is going on?
Aperture changes.
Okay. So as you're playing higher, the aperture becomes?
Smaller.
Okay, good. You know, if I ask these questions to any group outside of Detroit or New Orleans or Puerto Rico or a few other places, Minneapolis, then people will just stand there or sit there and look at me like, I have no idea. But you guys are learning that stuff and you're picking it up and I commend you for learning that much, because most people don't even get that. But once you start to get it, it opens up new doors. You start to think, oh, wait a minute. If airspeed is changing that, and my lips, my aperture is changing that, then, when I have that problem playing the high G to the high C, I can maybe fix it by working on those things, because then you know what might not be working. So we want to talk just a few minutes about how all of that works and get as far into each piece of it as you want to in the next half hour. Let's give Guyman an applause for...
Yeah.
Thank you for spending some time with us. Thank you very much. Sounded great. And you want to start to approach these things as, hey, this is the first time I've ever done it. But in my first trumpet lessons, we would go through all that, and then we would start to play different configurations, learning which vowels do which, and in different partials, changing the airspeed and manipulating your aperture. And those are the first things I ever teach in a lesson. And then the second lesson, we would start with usually the B or the C-sharp scale. So my students would come in, and I'd say, all right, let's play this note. And I would say, well, we need to figure out how to play a note higher than that. And they would mess around. We'd find a note. That'd be great. What's higher than that? And they'd figure it out. They'd be like... And we'd work a long time to figure out what note is next. But we would start on B or C sharp. And then by the end of that lesson, those kids will have learned this. All my students would learn the B or C sharp scale in their second lesson. Then in the third lesson, we would cover the chromatic scale. And most of the kids could play the chromatic scale 2 octaves in the third lesson. After that, we would make the B or the C sharp or both scales your warm up 2 octaves. All the lessons after that for the rest of the year. We wouldn't practice the C scale until after 6 months. We'd learn it, but we wouldn't spend time on it. Anybody, can you guess why I would do that? Sounds crazy, right?
Trial and error sounds like, you know, part of it.
Yeah, trial and error, sure. Mm-hmm.
So they're, you're not being told something, they're discovering.
Right. Do you know why it was either B or C sharp?
Could it be that those are both probably the worst keys to play in tune on the horn?
So most of us would consider those are really hard keys. Because when you look at them on a sheet of music, you've got all the sharps, or they could be C flat, or G flat, or D flat, or whatever flats or sharps. It can be really confusing for kids. The reason we ended up on either B or C sharp was because I would ask them when they played this note to find a note that was one half step off of that, because that's what I was going to teach them how to play, was the scale on the next note. I didn't want them to learn this. I didn't want them to practice that, because we all practice that, and then we go home there. I wanted the kids to go home with something really hard, because if they felt like that was easy, and that was home, then C scale is going to be easy, right? The reason it was B or C sharp is because when I'd ask them to play half a step off of that, some of them would play half steps lower and some would play half step higher. And that's the scale they learn first. And then the next lesson they'd learn the other scale. But I taught kids that are fourth and fifth graders to do it that way because I had this theory that people will learn whatever they want to learn. They'll learn whatever you teach them, but they'll especially learn whatever they're discovering themselves. If they're excited about it, then they're going to learn it. If you tell them to do it, a lot of times they're like, oh, man, I have to do that. But I mean, what if it was their idea to learn it, you know? So they get have some self-discovery, they get to choose it. So you guys could do the same thing. I mean, when you approach practice and you're like going into this, in your practice room or wherever you do it, maybe it's your kitchen, you're like, oh, I've got to practice this lick. Man, I just don't want to do it anymore because I don't like the lick. Then find the lick you like, you know? Play the stuff you really like, but then make that stuff harder. So maybe the lick is something easy. That's super easy, right? So now we'll just put that in every key. You know, I'm kidding, it's not that easy. But it's not crazy 30-second notes either. So what you want to do is practice the stuff you really want to practice, but then find ways to challenge yourself. I was challenging beginning students without even telling them. They had no idea that was hard stuff, you know? They didn't know you shouldn't play two octaves. The reason it was easier for them to play two octaves is because we went through air speed and we went through aperture and we discussed it. And as they would tell me how it works, I would lead them in the right direction until we got to these basic fundamental pieces of it, which are, as you play higher, your aperture becomes smaller. You don't have to tell people how to move their lips. You just have to know that the opening gets smaller as you go higher. I'm not going to stand here and tell you how many millimeters or inches to move stuff. I'm not going to give you weird exercises where you're like, oh man, I'm going to do a 16,000 lip trills or long tones or mouthpiece buzzing. What I want to give you is the fundamentals, the pieces, so you can put them together and find the balance. So we have airspeed and we have aperture. How do those go together? Can anybody tell me? How are they related? If I play a real small aperture, like, let's say that's small, and then I open it. How is my airspeed affected by that aperture?
Smaller apertures, higher airspeed, lower notes are slower airspeed and more volume.
Okay. And can we think of any analogies that are similar to that?
Garden hose.
Garden hose. Okay, you want to explain it, Andy?
The nozzle as you twist it, mm-hmm. it's making the opening smaller, and the same amount or the water pressure has to have somewhere to go and it builds higher.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so as it's a smaller nozzle, there's more back pressure.
Mm-hmm.
When it comes out, it's going faster, and then that faster would correlate to what on a note. Higher
note.
Yeah, and you could test that at home pretty easily. You could take your garden hose, if you have one of those twist nozzles at the end, and just point it straight up. If you open it all the way up, you know it's going to gurgle a couple feet maybe. And if you tighten it all the way up, it might be 30, 50 feet, right? It's a great analogy because it's basically how it works. The physics are that simple. You have faster air or faster water, And then you would have a smaller aperture to create the faster air. Now think about the volume of the water. How much water is coming out of the water hose when you have the nozzle all the way open? Well, let's say you took the nozzle off and it's just open.
More. Yeah.
So a lot of water, right? You get a lot more water. If you want to slow down the rate of water going into whatever you're trying to fill up, then you put your thumb over it then too. You know? It might make a little more mess, but if you're trying to get down to the end, or you just turn the spigot off, same thing is true on trumpet or on brass playing. When you are playing higher, then you are using less air.
Yeah.
Yeah. So if you want to play a really, really high note, and you want to play it with a little tiny bit of air, what does that note sound like? Is it loud or soft?
Just soft.
A little bit. Soft. So as we play higher, physics basically states that the higher you play on a brass instrument, the softer it becomes, the less decibels you have, the less amplitude. It's actually true on piano, it's true on violin, it's true on flute and saxophone, and it's on all the instruments, that's true. Now, some of the instruments, you really have to force it to get those high notes out, or at least we think you have to. So trumpet and saxophone, both of those instruments, we tend to do what when we play high notes? If you want to have a real exciting solo and impress...
A little more.
Yeah, you want to impress everybody, you're going to play really loud, right? So we have this misconception that high notes are supposed to be loud. But in reality, physics states that they should get softer and softer as you go higher. So when you're playing your arpeggios or your scales or anything else, technically, if you're doing it correctly, they should get softer as you play higher. And I'll play a couple for you. Now, it's not dramatic, but I'm playing louder on the low notes, softer on the high notes. It's not something that always naturally happens, because when you ask someone to play a high note and it's beyond where they can go, a lot of people try to do what they've seen. And everybody in the whole world has seen a trumpet player do this. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Because we're like, I need to get that note. And I'm going to push out all my air to get there. Does that work?
No.
For a lot of players, it actually works. Now, for some of us, we don't do it. I actually do that sometimes. If I want to play really high and really loud, I push really hard. So it does work. But what if you wanted to play really high and really soft? Can you do it that way? You can. So if you want to play really high and really soft, you're going to have to use less air. The easiest way to do that is take a deep breath and then let it out. It's just a little bit of air. Hardly anything. If I want to play that loud, that's when you get to push. That's when you do the Bobby Shue wedge, or you do Maynard Ferguson techniques where he's just like, squeezing his whole body, you know? That's when you do that stuff. It's only when you're going to play high and loud. Now, I want to warn everybody that if your goal is to play high and loud, that's great. Just know that it will damage things in your body eventually. It's not good for your body because it goes against the rules of physics. Our bodies are designed... physics is nothing more than a way of explaining the natural world. And we are natural people. We're part of the world. And to push really hard on a high note exerts a ton of force inside your body, and a lot of people get hurt doing it. Does anyone know anyone who's suffered some kind of injury from playing high and low? I know a lot of people. What are some of the things that could happen?
Lightheadedness.
Okay, lightheadedness. Have you ever seen anyone fall off a bandstand? Or have you done it? Or have you had to go down like this and be like, oh, all I see is black? I hope nobody noticed that. Okay. I'm going to get up and play the next part.
Yeah, that's happened to me.
I'm fine. Right. Totally fine. And you're white, right?
Yeah, that's happened to me.
Yeah. I mean, right? Why does that happen?
Yeah. I got hyperventilated.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, literally.
Doesn't your blood pressure skyrocket? Doesn't your blood pressure skyrocket when you bear down to...
It definitely can. For most people, it does. And it creates so much pressure inside your body that it squeezes the vascular system. So it's putting pressure in places you shouldn't have that pressure. You could easily cause a heart attack, especially for most of us who are over a certain age. We could kill ourselves doing this, you know? So, yeah, go ahead.
I was going to say, I had a friend of mine, and he could also do damage. He was practicing piccolo trumpet, and I don't know what was going on, but he passed out, fell on his mouthpiece, can't play trumpet anymore.
Really? That's horrible. I mean, I've seen a lot of people drop their horns for various reasons. The excuses I hear are interesting. I always wonder.